Okay, so the history lesson portion for today has to do with this stuff with the causes that we talked about. And Aristotle was kind of unique in the history of philosophy in that one of the things that he typically does is he wants to see what everybody else has had to say about a topic before he starts to talk about it. Now, that probably strikes you as pretty commonsensical, right? Before you open your mouth about something, you know, you've probably learned this from experience, it's probably a good idea to see if anybody else had something to say about it, so you're not saying exactly the same thing, or you're not, you know, reinventing the wheel, you're not wasting everybody's time, right? And when you write a paper, you do a literature review quite often. That's one of the reasons. Aristotle is one of the first people to do this systematically in philosophy. And the reason he does it is because he realizes that nobody's ever completely wrong. Even wrong-headed views, there's always some grain of truth in them. And what you want to be able to do as a philosopher, or as somebody just learning how to do philosophy, like all of you are, is to extract that grain of truth and then get rid of the rest of the stuff. You know, this is what you call criticism. Criticism is figuring out what's right and what's wrong in something, and then, you know, saying why and getting rid of the stuff that you don't want. And then synthesis is bringing it in and integrating it into a larger picture. And that's what Aristotle's going to do. So you notice in Metaphysics Book 1, he's talking about a lot of people. This is the history lesson part. He starts out saying, well, in the beginning, people talked about material causes. Instead of, you know, there's a sort of in the beginning story that all of you are familiar with, I think, right, from our culture. In the beginning, you know, God created the heavens and earth. This isn't a story like that. This is a story about, in the beginning, when human beings started to think about this kind of stuff, first they started to think about what is everything made of. And it was only, you know, one person in 10,000 who was thinking about this. Most people were just going about their day. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about this first guy, Thales, who you don't know that much about. Actually, none of us know that much about him because there's not a lot of written records about him. One thing that we do know is that he thought everything was made out of water. So, now you may think, so this guy's a nut, yeah? Because everything isn't made out of water, is it? Where would somebody get a crazy idea like that from? Well, you know, Thales was a guy who was very observant. He actually made a killing in the commodities market at the time by watching the weather. I'll tell you that story in just a moment. He looked at things as they took place, and he noticed something very unusual about water that you don't see happening with a lot of other things. Think back to your chemistry classes or your biology classes. How is water different in your experience than most other things? Is it present in just one form in your daily experience? Two?
Three,
right. It's present as a solid when it gets cold enough, and it got cold enough in Greece for them to see that. And it's present as a liquid that is ubiquitous. We use it for all sorts of things. And it's also present as a gas. All you have to do is heat it a little bit, and you can get it to do that. And you can see this with some other things like metals, right? You heat up lead. You don't have to get it very hot, and it turns into molten lead. And you can take a lot of other things and burn them, and you know, you get ashes, and they change into things. But water stays the same when you make it go from one thing to another. And water's everywhere. You know, if you think about it, your body's mostly water, right? You all remember that from your chemistry classes. Most of the earth is covered by water. And it kind of makes sense if you have to pick one single thing that everything was going to be made of. Water could be a candidate, couldn't it? And, you know, he thought that Earth was like water that had been just compacted even more and it had assumed a certain form. This isn't actually that far away from our notion of atomic theory, is it? You know, we have neutrons and electrons and protons, and they're arranged in different ways, and squish them all together and you get bigger and bigger complexes. So Thales was doing this, and Friedrich Nietzsche, who's a philosopher we're not going to read in this class, but who's a very important metaphysician, among other things, when he's talking about Thales, he said what Thales did was really philosophical. It's almost the beginnings of philosophy. And why? Because Thales actually asked the question, not what is this thing made of, what is everything made of? What is substance? What lies behind the appearances that we're looking at? What does this have in common with this and have in common with this air? What do all these things have in common? So, you know, I mean, his answer is not one that we'd probably accept. Everything's made of water. And then if we go on from there, Aristotle says, we get other people. And they're all talking about this material cause, what's everything made of. Anaximenes says that air is the primary substance. Air is prior to water. You condense air and you get water, in his view. Hippasus and Heraclitus said that it was fire. That was the primary element. And then finally we get to Empedocles. And Empedocles says, no, I think there's four elements, four different kinds of things. Earth, air, fire, water. And everything that we know is built up out of these things. And that was the sort of common take on material substances until, well, at least in the West, until well into the Renaissance. If you read medieval philosophers, if you read other ancient philosophers, they will talk about the four elements. Sometimes they'll talk about a fifth element, ether, the quintessence, the fifth essence. If you guys have ever seen that movie, The Fifth Element, it's based on that sort of notion, except, you know, it has all sorts of crazy aliens in it, too, and Mila Jovovich and shoot-em-up scenes and things like that. Now, all of this is focusing on understanding things in terms of their material causes. And that's one way to understand things. What are things made of? Let's say you understand a human being. What could you do? You could actually dissect a human being. Any of you that are pre-med, if you don't like dissecting things, you're in the wrong field, because sooner or later you have to actually do it on a cadaver, which is, you know, a dead human being. So you should probably think it over, whether you're up for that or not. If you're going to be a veterinarian, you're going to dissect a lot of animals. If you look at things that way, we're just a bunch of organs and meat and bones and a little bit of fat, sometimes more fat, you know, somebody like me, and a lot of water, right? Blood's mostly water. Does that actually tell you what a human being is, though? If you know, you bring home your boyfriend or girlfriend to mom and dad, and they're out in the car, and they're kind of shy, so they're not coming in quite yet, and mom and dad say, tell me a little bit about Joe or Jenny or what, you know, whatever. And you say, well, you know, he's made of bones and blood, and what else did we say? You know, liver and kidneys and things like that. He's got a big brain. Most you know, human beings do. That's not going to tell them very much about that particular human being, nor does it tell them much about any human being. I mean, that's good if we want to look at things in terms of material causes, but we want to know about the other stuff, too. Now, there are some things that we could be happy with just knowing the material cause. You know. Then we have a transition. So Aristotle's telling the story some more. He says, we have a transition where we're moving from material causes to efficient causes. We want to know, and this takes a long time. This takes decades for people to think this out. Because, you know, it wasn't a society like we live in with with information being transferred all the time. Is that still on?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't see the red thing.
Yeah, it has the red numbers.
Okay. Oh, that's good. And one of the there are two different tendencies with this. One of the tendencies is what he calls monistic philosophies, where they think that there's one main thing that gets everything, you know, everything ends up coming out of it, or everything ends up being it. If you hear the term monism, think of this notion, everything is one. And then there's what are called the atomists. And this is where we actually got the first notion of atoms as we know them in chemistry from. It came from philosophy. So the monists were people like Parmenides. Parmenides said being is, non-being isn't. Anything that you would claim is going from being to non-being, like, for instance, when I eat this biscotti, that's taking it from its being to non-being. It's no longer going to exist once I eat it, right? Not at least as biscotti. It'll exist in my stomach, I guess, as ingredients. He would say that's an illusion. And he had to because of his philosophy. If you say that everything is just one thing, one of the ways that you can go with that is there really is no change. There really is no motion. That's kind of a hard philosophy to buy and to believe. Not a lot of people actually did. Melissus, another person along these lines, said what's one is matter itself. And then there was Xenophanes, who said, according to Aristotle, that the one is actually the divine, God. And there we have something kind of similar to certain Eastern religions. Have any of you done any study, like in your previous classes, of world religions, anything like along those lines? There are some religions, Hinduism is a good example, in which many of the believers will assert that at some level everything is God. Like the whole universe are all just, you know, bits of God or aspects of God. Maybe Xenophanes was saying something along those lines. Now again, think of your boyfriend or girlfriend that you're bringing home to meet mom or dad. Does knowing that they're a tiny little bit of God tell you much about them? It might make you feel nice towards them if they're a little bit of God, right? Nicer than you were when you didn't think that they were. But it doesn't really tell you much. It's not helping you to understand the thing that much. So let's look at what the atomists said. So the atomists were people like Leucippus and Democritus, and then later on somebody who I had originally scheduled us to read, but then I had to take out because of our rain day, Epicurus. And they believe that everything that we're seeing here is made of atoms. So it's similar to the view that modern science holds, right? And atom literally means that which cannot be cut. It comes from ah, which means not, and then tmen, in Greek, which means to cut into pieces, like I accidentally did setting it down with the biscotti, right? I didn't cut it, I broke it. An atom can't be broken. So it's a little different than our understanding of atoms now, because we think atoms can be broken. We make bombs, you know, based on that principle. But the atoms are the basic building blocks of everything else. And the ways in which they move, the ways in which they're composed, determine all the things. So why is this edible? And this not. It can explain that, can't it? This isn't edible because it's not made of atoms in the right configuration for us to be able to chew them, let alone digest them. And I suppose there could be little bits of this that you could chew and swallow, but you wouldn't digest them, I hope. Whereas this, unless I baked it wrong, this is chewable and digestible. We can break the atoms in this down and make them part of our own configuration of atoms. That's what we do when we eat. So Aristotle says, okay, now we've gotten to the efficient cause, and then we have other ways of understanding the efficient cause as well. They eventually start thinking in terms of efficient causes as not just what things are made of, and then going to this, like atoms, rather than just being material, are also efficient causes. They start thinking in terms of intelligence. How did things get to be the way they are? How did they get to be arranged the way they are? This is where we start to get to really interesting stuff. I mean, science is pretty interesting, but speculating about intelligence is much more interesting. So, you know, Aristotle says it doesn't seem as if fire or earth or any other kind of material element should be the reason why things manifest goodness or beauty or intelligence in their being. So, think about something that you actually find beautiful. Is that beautiful just because of the way atoms were put together? You know? Think about something that has intelligence, like your neighbor in the classroom. And the fact that you can think about them as being intelligent means you're intelligent too, right? Could that have happened just as a chance coming together of a bunch of atoms? And there are some people who hold that theory, right, in our society. There have been people who have held that theory throughout history in all different cultures. But Aristotle says that doesn't really seem as if that could happen just randomly. So another possibility is the efficient cause would be some sort of mind or intelligence. Now, if you're a traditional Greek, what would you call that? You've got stories about how things got to be the way they are. You guys remember Greek mythology? You probably had a bit of it in English class or something like that, right? What are some of the myths that you remember? Remember any of them? You've seen some on TV, I'm sure, because some of them have been turned into TV stories. Anybody know why the Greeks thought there was winter? This one comes a little bit later, but it's because Persephone has to go down to the land of the dead 6 months out of the year to live with her husband. And her mom, who is the goddess of grain and, you know, harvest and vegetables and all that sort of stuff, Ceres, or Demeter, hates it so much that she turns the earth into a wasteland. Well, you know, what that's saying is that the reason why we have meteorological phenomena is not just because of material things, but because some intelligence, some powerful intelligence affects them. If you have a creation story, like the Judeo-Christian creation story, you know, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, that's saying that God would be the efficient cause, not just the heavens and the earth. You know, I mean, you could have told the story this way. The heavens and the earth just kind of created themselves and, you know, randomly wound up that way, and here we are. That's another way to tell that story, isn't it? And then the heavens and the earth are the efficient cause. But in the traditional story, it's a god that's the cause. Some of the other philosophers said that it was other things. Empedocles talks about love. Love does what? It brings things together and reconciles things. It makes the elements work together. And then, of course, hate or strife pulls them apart. Anaxagoras says that mind like the mind that you have, is the cause that made the whole universe the way it is. It got everything going. Some sort of mind. He doesn't call it God, he just calls it mind. So that's pretty good. So now we have two causes, right? Is that enough? Does that explain everything? Well, if it did, then Pythagoras and Plato wouldn't have brought up the formal cause. The formal cause is some sort of structure that you can think about. What do you guys remember about Pythagoras from algebra class?
Pythagorean theorem,
yeah. And that was actually a secret that was kept for a while, in part because of their philosophy. Because the numbers didn't all turn out rationally, and they liked the numbers to be rational. You know why? Because they thought numbers were the building blocks of everything. They thought that the universe, and there are some people who think this, there are some scientific ways of understanding the world that view it this way, that numbers underlie everything and are the formal cause for why things are the way that they are. And now the Pythagoreans kind of went hog wild with this. You know, once you find some sort of explanatory principle, you guys are gonna, you guys have probably done this at one time in your life, and you're gonna keep on doing it. Once you find some sort of explanatory principle, your tendency is to try to apply it to everything, right? So you take a psych class, and now you're analyzing everybody in terms of abnormal psychology. Good idea or bad idea? Why is it a bad idea? I mean, if they are crazy, it's a good idea. But why is it a bad idea? It's called abnormal psychology because it's about normal people?
Abnormal
people, right. And abnormal people are not everybody. So if you take an abnormal psychology class and then you decide, all right, I've learned what a paranoid is, what a schizophrenic is, what a bipolar person is, and now everybody I'm going to run across is one of those three. Well, that may not be a good way to do it. The Pythagoreans were doing that with numbers. Plato does it with something else. Remember, was it two class sessions ago, right? We talked about the theory of the forms. That's one of the things that Plato is contributing. The form of human being that's the same for me as it is for her, as it is for her, as it is for him, that's something that makes us be what we are. Right? Think about it this way. Let's say we talk about it in terms of biology. You're a bunch of atoms put together in certain ways. A lot of carbon, a lot of hydrogen, a lot of oxygen, a lot of nitrogen, and a bunch of other stuff, right? I got to pick somebody who looks radically different from me. So many dark-haired people in the class. You got more or less blonde hair. Why do you have blonde hair and I have dark hair?
I don't want to talk about it. No, I'm not just blonde, I guess.
Well, you're not just blonde. There's some sort of cause that's in your biology. It's not just the way your atoms are. It's your DNA, right? Were your parents blonde, or you got blonde people in your family, or?
Nah.
Somewhere you do.
My mom has red hair, my dad has black hair.
Ah, who knows where you got it from, then, you know? Whether your hair is going to turn gray early or not, my dad's hair turned gray when he was like 18. I'm glad I'm adopted, because I meant that mine didn't. That's all genetic stuff, right? And you could think of it in terms of the atoms are the material cause, what you're made of. And your genetics are the formal cause. And your genetics and my genetics are more than 99% the same. That's why we're all human beings. As a matter of fact, chimpanzees are like 98% the same as a human being. Pretty close, you know. Even worms are like 40% the same as us when it comes to the formal cause. That 40% makes a big difference, but... Well, no, 60%, I'm sorry. 60% of it is a different part. But you could still think of it in terms of that formal cause, what things have in common. That's not exactly the way Plato talks about it, but this is a way to sort of analogize it. Plato thought of it in terms of the theory of the forms. Aristotle says all these guys left out something. They were kind of hinting at it, and Plato kind of got at it, but they left out the final cause. The reason why things are the way they are, the what for, the purpose, the function of things. And so here is where the history lesson ends, and we start to do the props part, which you might enjoy a bit more. At least I hope you do. And, you know, you notice that I created a handout where I give you a whole bunch of examples of different ways that we can understand basic things. And so, you know, let's start with the first one. I had, you know, bread, a loaf of bread, but we could use a biscotti. I had this left over from lunch, I brought it from home. Now it's broken, but you get the idea, right? What's the material cause of this? What is this made of? Those of you who do any baking, you know what goes into this sort of stuff. What goes into it?
Flour.
Flour? And can you guess anything else that might go into it? What do most recipes seem to call for? Eggs? This takes 3 eggs in a batter or a batch of biscotti. Stick of butter. Some baking powder, not soda. If you mix them up, you screw things up. So you don't want to mix up baking powder and baking soda. Those are all material things. Those are the things I'm putting in the bowl as I'm mixing it, right? I'm actually one of the efficient causes of the biscotti turning out like this, for better or for worse. I tend to undercook them. These I actually burnt a little bit, which is why it broke so easily. But I'm taking all these ingredients and I'm doing something. What makes it a biscotti and not, say, a loaf of bread? You know, look at the shape of it. Oop, it's breaking even more. Not a loaf of bread, is it? It's a kind of cookie. Part of that is due to the matter. Part of it's due to how you cook it. Have any of you ever played around with this, cooking biscotti? It's a double process. First you put it out in like a big kind of lump that you spread out, and that swells up, and then you have to slice it after it's cooked halfway through. And you take each of the slices and you lay them down flat. That's how it gets so hard. So when you go to Starbucks next time and you get a biscotti, that's where your biscotti came from. It was originally a big loaf like bread, and then it was given a different form. Right? What's its purpose? I mean, you could do a lot of things with it. If we had a chair leg that was, you know, wobbly, we could stick this underneath, couldn't we? Or a table, you know, people do that at restaurants. Is that its purpose? I mean, that we could do that with it, but is that really its purpose?
Well, since we made it, it's to be eaten is its purpose.
Yeah.
Because we made it, it was a bunch of different things before.
Exactly. We've given it purpose. or we've discovered its purpose. And, you know, if I don't eat it, there's probably something wrong with me. You know, if I just leave that sitting around and I say, you got to check out my biscotti. You know, it's so wonderful. You know, at some point in time, you'll probably say, you know, it's just a biscotti. It's not a museum piece. Why don't you eat that thing? That would be pointing out to me its final cost. You can think about these, right? Ibuprofen. I'm sure some of you have taken these when you get injured in sports, or you stress it too much, or maybe you have arthritis or something like that. And you know, you can actually look on the bottle and it tells you what the matter is. It's pretty easy to. It's just ibuprofen. Whatever ibuprofen actually is, I don't know what it is. And then it tells you some other things it's got in here: silicon dioxide, cornstarch, iron oxides, titanium dioxide. I don't know what half of this stuff is, but what I do know is that's what it's made of. And what's its form? Well, you know, you can get these pills in a lot of different shapes. Here's its form. It's round and flat, pill-shaped, right? Nothing surprising about that. What's the efficient class? What brings this to actually be? Where do you get them?
The store.
Drugstore, right. And where does a drugstore just, you know, go out and pick them from the ibuprofen tree? No? Well, yeah.
A pharmacist makes them.
A pharmacist makes them. Yeah, for certain pills. I think for these, they're like mass-produced because they're over-the-counter. But you're right, for certain types of pills, you actually have to get a pharmacist who will mix the things together and concoct them. So the pharmacist could be the efficient cause. Or the machine that makes the pills could be the efficient cause. What is the final cause? Why do people take ibuprofen? For the same reason as biscotti, to satisfy hunger. You'd have to eat a lot of these little pills to fill yourself up, wouldn't you? And if you did, you'd really screw up your stomach in the process. Why do people take it? It's a painkiller, right? That tells you what its final cause is. Notice that something can have a major final cause, and you can give it other final causes. You might buy these not because you actually want to take them as painkillers, but because you want to take them to the movie theater, and instead of throwing, what do people throw in the movie theater? Like jujubes and... I can't remember those things, the little drops, you know. People would throw popcorn. This is when I was a kid. People would throw things in the theater. You could maybe take a bottle of ibuprofen and just throw those. But would that really be its purpose? You would be giving it that purpose, but that's adding something on, isn't it, to something that already has all these causes. To understand what that thing is, you can understand those causes. A human being, we talked about this before. What am I made of? Same stuff you're made of. You know, if you opened us up, it wouldn't be very pretty. But, you know, it's enlightening. We're just a bunch of organs and skin and bones and blood and, you know, stuff like that. Nerves. That's our material cause. Our formal cause is the form of humanity. And you know, it's kind of interesting. Aristotle, I think I pointed this out to you before, Aristotle says that we are rational animal. That's our definition. He had another crazy definition, non-feathered biped, you know, because chickens walk on two legs, and we walk on two legs, but they have feathers and we don't. But this distinguishes us even better. We're rational. We can think, we can talk, we can communicate, we can pass on information, we have culture. Is that a matter of your guts and your blood and your bones or anything like that? Can you take let's say you were doing, you know, sort of a Frankenstein experiment. Can you go to the human being parts store and get a whole bunch of parts and put them all together and then get lightning maybe and wind up with a rational animal? That's one of the problems with the Frankenstein story, isn't it? He doesn't turn out to be all that rational. He does in the book, actually, though, but not in the movie. That's our formal cause. That's what makes us us. What is our efficient cause? Here's an interesting thing to think about. Who made you? We all know where babies come from, right? You know, mom and dad got together on some occasion, and your dad contributed one type of genetic material, and your mom contributed another type. And, you know, all the things aligned at that time. And the sperm fertilized the egg, and here you are. That's your efficient cause. Sperm and an egg coming together. Now you can go back further. Where'd your mom and dad come from? Well, you have grandparents, don't you? Where did they come from? You can keep tracing it back further and further and further. But you get the idea, don't you? Human beings have efficient causes. We are something like a product, just as much as a biscotti is. We come from something. Here's the really tricky one. What's our final cause? What is our purpose? This, I imagine, is something that you guys are trying to figure out for yourself while you're in college. And your answers to it probably change every day, don't they? Some days it seems like your purpose is to satisfy your mom and dad's expectations. Other days it seems like it's to have a good time as much as you possibly can. Other times it seems like to prepare yourself for an endless, you know, life of drudgery ahead. Other times it seems like opening your mind up to all sorts of new opportunities. But, you know, it's really a good question to ask. Do human beings have a final cause? Aristotle thinks that they do, and he calls that final cause happiness. Other people might place it in terms of a religious object. If they believe, for instance, that God is the ultimate efficient cause, usually the final cause is something like being with God.
Does he think our final cause is?
Who, Aristotle?
Yeah.
Happiness. To live a life that is actively engaging virtue, that has enough means to be able to do so comfortably, and that is pleasant because of that. He also thinks most people don't get to live it. Most of us miss, it's kind of pessimistic, most of us miss our final cause. Just like this biscotti, you know, if I decide not going to eat this one because I don't like broken biscotti, I don't care actually, but let's say I'm picky, I'm not going to eat this one. That biscotti has actually missed its final cause. It's sort of like that, remember the Rudolph show? The Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer and the Island of Misfit Toys? You guys still watch those? No, I don't mean still watch those like, you know, you watch them now. I mean, when you were kids, did you watch those? Remember the train with the wheels that were square and all that? They would have missed their final cause, which was to bring pleasure to children, right? Our final cause would be something that we enjoy ourselves.
Whatever we make it to be.
That's what some philosophers have said. Not everybody sees it the same way that Aristotle does. Some people think that human beings don't have a final cause. That if individuals do, it's because they make it to be that way. Let's look at some other things. So, did you guys have these when you were like in fourth grade, music class?
Those things suck.
You know, they're not that bad if you really, you know, get a good one and work with it and all that. But yeah, you're right. I actually broke mine on another kid's head.
I got a Lego stuck in it. Mine made a really weird noise.
Yeah. They don't have a very big range, you're right.
I can't spawn.
Yeah. Now, a recorder. What are they usually made of? Two things usually, right?
Plastic.
This one's made of plastic. Or, if you're fancy, wood. Porcelain? Somebody said. I can't imagine that one lasting long. You probably could make one out of porcelain because it's just a whistle. What's its formal cause? The shape that it has, right? The structure. That's what actually allows it to have its notes. You know, these little holes here have to be so far apart from each other and so big in order for you to have a scale. The efficient cause, in this case, this is mass-produced by the Honer Corporation, made in Germany. So some factory in Germany is the efficient cause. What's the final cause? To aggravate you in fourth grade, make you learn hot cross buns. That's a byproduct.
Play music,
right. And we could go further from that. We could say, well, why are these things designed for playing music? Why do we play music?
Entertainment.
Yeah. So it could have a final cause, which could then lead us to another final cause. We can have efficient causes, and we can go back with those. With material causes, we can sometimes go several levels down. You know, I mean, this not so much, right? Because this is plastic, so you know exactly what kind of matter it is. What about something like this? Another flip cam. Lots of moving parts not a lot of moving parts in here because it's a flash camera, but it's got some moving parts. What is the material that this is made of? Plastic is part of it, yeah. Some parts are metal.
Glass.
Yeah, there's probably some...
It's like fake glass, I'm guessing.
Well, you mean like for the lens?
Well, yeah.
Are you talking about like the circuit boards?
Like the screen.
Oh, yeah. That's a type of...
Type of glass.
Something. LED, I guess, right? And then the insides are all computer bits. And what are those made of? Okay, well, the computer bits could be the material cause, but you can go further. What do we make computer parts out of? Silicon. That's why they call it Silicon Valley. So you can, and you can take things like this and make them parts of larger holes, too. Like, you know, when I put that together with the tripod. Now you have a larger unit. So, and your body is like this too, you know, if you look at your organs, what are your organs composed of?
Tissue,
and tissue is composed of?
Cells
right, and you ever like looked at one of those cells and looked at the stuff inside? That's kind of complicated too, isn't it? So, even the material cause is broken down further and further, and, you know, something could be both a material cause for one thing, and a formal cause for another thing, depending on how you're looking at it. I have another musical instrument here, one that maybe doesn't have quite so bad associations for all of you. This is one of my most prized possessions. It was actually my dad's. And it's a long neck banjo with a small drum. So, this is older than me, and since I no longer carry life insurance, worth more than me in a lot of respects. And, you know, what is we can ask the same thing with this as we can with this. Same final cause, right? To make music. What is its material cause? It's different than this, isn't it? What is this made of? Wood is part of it, yeah. What else? What else do you see?
Metal.
Strings are themselves metal of some sort. Although you could do it with like fishing line if you want to be really hillbilly about it.
You should play something.
You're gonna play that, right?
Yeah.
I'm gonna play a little bit, but towards the end. Plastic, right? Some plastic pegs, which I guess probably back in 1965 were kind of state of the art, you know. Anything else we're missing? Oh, whatever this is made of. I don't even know what this is made of. Could be. But you can see through it. So I don't know. Might be some sort of plastic. So that's the material cause. What's the formal cause? This is put together in a very different way, isn't it? Would this be a banjo if it had a different shape to it here? It might be a different kind of instrument, right? Like a guitar? Or if it had the triangle thing, it could be a balalaika, I think they call those. If it was kind of squished in together, it could be a mandolin. So, you know, the shape of it, the structure of it, all that matters. You don't tune this quite the same way as you do a guitar. The strings are at different intervals. This is a drone string that just plays the same note all the time. That's part of its formal structure. Who made this? The Vega company. It's actually got a little thing inside, number, you know, 11815, the model number, all that sort of stuff. This is made in Boston, turns out. I never actually looked at that. So this is made in Boston, you know, during the folk age when people were into this sort of stuff. And final cause to make music. We could ask about all the different final causes. Now I'd like you to think about something else. Something that you can't actually see, but is equally real. So, with this, let's say you play a note. Okay, so that's a G, right? This is probably out of tune, so it's probably... That's pretty close. Now, is that the same note? It is in some respects. Why do we say it's the same note? This is where we're getting into metaphysical questions.
Is it the same sound?
Okay, very good. So they have the same formal pause. They fit in the same place on the scale. How did I make this note? What did I do?
You vibrated the string.
Very good. Efficient pause is something different. String vibrating. What's striking your ears are sound waves. So the material pause is the same. How am I making this sound?
Blowing into it.
Right. So there is a different process of efficient causality there. If we only look at it in terms of the formal cause or the material cause, it's the same sound. If we look at it in terms of where it came from, it's not the same sound, is it? You notice that things look differently depending on what vantage point you adopt. And what about the final cause? I mean, the final cause for these right now is something a little bit different than just making music. It was to teach you something. Now you can put things together in larger complexes. You can't do it with a recorder. You can do it with a recorder in one way, right? You could play hot cross buns, like you said. And actually, I haven't played this for a very long time, so I'm not going to try to play anything on the recorder. Does anyone here, can anyone here play it? Well? Let's just imagine that somebody did, right? Okay, so somebody has played this recorder, and they created the thing, which will be a song. Let's think this all up. What's the material cause of a song? What is a song made of?
Sound waves.
Yeah, but those sound waves...
Notes.
Notes, exactly. So, now if we want to go down further, you're right, sound waves. And who makes them? The instrument makes them, doesn't it? So the instrument is an efficient cause. Does the instrument do it by itself? Except in Disney movies? You know, when little things go crazy and candlesticks dance and all that sort of stuff. What makes the instrument do it? Somebody actually has to, like, you know, sit here and blow in it and make it do the sound. So let's say it's you, back in fourth grade, playing hot cross buns. And why are you playing that song? What's the final cause of that? Those of you who had recorders and didn't follow up with your recorder, you know, virtuosity or whatever, to become great recorder players, why were you playing it that day?
The teacher said so.
Yeah, that's a reason, that's a cause for something. Satisfy someone. Now, you can put things together in other ways too. This is also, you know, a little side note. Remember we talked about the Pythagoreans and mathematics? Do you know where they got a lot of their ideas from mathematics from? From music. Because music is actually in large respect based on mathematics. If we have that same tone, that G note, right? What happens if we play two other notes with it, like this? What if we play them all together? Anybody know what we call that in music?
A chord.
A chord, very good. And we can have all sorts of levels of things. So a song is made up of chords, which are made up of notes being played together. You can change, like this at least, this doesn't have the quite of flexibility that a guitar has. There's not so much you can do with a banjo. But you can strum, right? You can pick. You can do a sort of claw hammer sort of thing. There's a lot of different variations. I suppose you could do weird stuff too, like, you know, saw it with a violin bow or things like that to make sounds. All of those are different ways of doing that efficient clause. With each song that you listen to on the radio, it's all coming down to building blocks like this fretboard and somebody actually fretting a chord, playing a chord, playing another chord, moving to another chord. That's what songs are made of. Everything within your experience, at least Aristotle thinks, everything that you encounter can be made sense of in terms of these four causes. That's been my main object, trying to get you to see that. You know, and so bringing in a banjo livens things up a little bit and hopefully gets you to see that. This banjo by itself is sort of a nexus of four causes. The sounds that it makes, another set of four causes in those. We can put them all together into compositions, another four causes. We can decide with each of these what the point is, what's going to make it, what structure does it have, what are the basic building blocks. Let's say you actually wanted to get good at playing this. You would have to pay attention to that, wouldn't you? You would have to actually pay attention to all four of those causes. If you want to play a song, you can't play it without any notes, can you? So if you want to play Mary Had a Little Lamb, you got to know something like five notes, I think. Right? Maybe four notes. Four notes altogether. If you want to play an AC/DC song, you got to know about three chords. Or a blues song, you got to know about three chords. If you want to play more complicated stuff, you got to know a lot of chords, right? If you want the song to sound good, it's not just a matter of having those chords down. You actually have to play them at the right time, at the right speed, put together in the right way. Or else it's not the song, is it? You have to pay attention to how you're doing it. If the song calls for you to be strumming, and you're not strumming, and instead you're picking, you are playing a somewhat different song. You also need to know what the point of your activity is. Is it to make money? Well, then you'd probably have to get a lot better at it than if your point is just to have fun. I play the banjo just to, you know, have fun, so I don't even play banjo music most of the time. I actually take a lot of heavy metal and pop and some folk songs that are supposed to be played on the guitar, and I play them on the banjo. Because that's my final cause is amuse myself. And, you know, a few other people, my fiance, my kids. If my goal was to make money, then I had better learn a lot of other songs, because nobody's going to pay you to go around and play the Ace of Spades on the banjo, or, you know, AC/DC songs, or John Cougar Mellencamp songs, or things like that. They're going to pay you to go around and play banjo music, right? So you have to think about all these clauses. When you're writing a paper the next time, think about your paper in terms of these causes. Your paper has a material cause. What is the material cause of your paper? I don't mean the paper itself. When you write a paper, like you're doing, some of you are actually writing things on your laptops right now. What are you writing? What's that?
Notes.
Are you composing stuff? Like music?
Oh, I thought you were taking a class. No, I'm like taking notes.
If you're writing a paper.
Oh, my bad.
Oh, you're writing notes. I was still thinking music. Okay. No, my bad. See? Yeah, you could be writing, you could be taking notes. If you're doing that, what are the building blocks of those notes? What do you actually type? Letters, and then those letters become larger units that we call
words.
Right. Sentences, paragraphs, yeah. The formal cause would be the structure of the thing as a whole. You're the efficient cause. Right? You're the one doing it. Why are you taking notes? There's your final cause. Is anybody in here taking notes just because they love the activity of taking notes? They can't help themselves from doing it. It's like an obsession with them. That's good. That's not the case. Why are you guys taking notes?
So we don't fail this class.
That's a rather pessimistic way of looking at it. But that's a good reason, too. You could set the bar higher than just not failing.
So we remember what you said.
So you remember. Yeah, so you succeed in the class, right? Right now, I don't think there's anybody in danger of failing this class. So you see that, again, everything that we think about, everything that we experience, everything that we do things with, whether it's an action, a material object, a composition, our bodies, the bodies of other things, a piece of machinery, everything that we can think of can be made sense of in terms of causality. This is a really deep metaphysical concept. It's because of this that the world that you currently live in looks the way that it does. Because it has been modified in so many different ways to become things. Like, you know, iPhones and pain-killing pills and wireless mouses and ties. All these things have come about because somebody has taken some material, put it into a certain form for some reason. That's why the world that you live in looks the way that it does in all of its parts. That's going to continue on the rest of your life. So if you think about these phenomena in those terms, I think this will bring more intelligibility. It'll help you understand them better. You can use this analysis or something like it in any field that you're going into. It takes some practice. We did a little bit here, right? You guys are now fairly good at identifying what's the material cause, what's the formal cause, what's the efficient cause, what's the final cause. But you would still have to keep up with it. I only wanted to introduce you to the idea, because this is an introduction to philosophy class. But now you see what the applicability of it is. So that's where we're going to leave off. Anybody have any questions about this stuff? No? All right.